Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. The Republican Party is falling apart at the seams, mainly because they have no idea what they even stand for anymore. We'll bring you the details. Donald Trump wants to convince voters that he wasn't born into a life of privilege, and we'll discuss his motivations for trying to rewrite his own history. And Hillary Clinton is trying to paint Bernie Sanders as a sexist, so we'll examine the records of the two candidates to see who is better on women's rights issues. That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flag.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
So, Farron, interesting comments from Bill Daley, who was a former Obama chief of staff, and comments which, you know, I'm sure, well, I got to say that I find a little bit annoying. And this week, Daley, who was chief of staff under President Obama from 2011 and 2012, this is when a lot of really bad deals, really some of the biggest bad deals, were cut. And frankly, Joe Biden was instrumental in cutting those deals. But he came out this week, and you know, this has obviously been an incredibly, I guess, prominent week if you wanted to showcase just how insane the Republican Party has been, which, you know, frankly, you could also say about last week and the week before and so on. But between the debate, between all this budget stuff, between Paul Ryan's problems, et cetera, et cetera. The idea that Bill Daley espouses is that the Republican Party basically went off the rails when Sarah Palin was nominated. And I'll tell you why I find it a little bit annoying. Because, and Farron, you know, you and I have been talking about these things for years. I mean, for a decade. In 2006, I wrote a book saying that with Stephen Sherrill called FUBAR. I don't know if you can get it other than, you know, in the discount bins. But the book was a comedic attempt to communicate the idea that the Republican Party that existed then in 2006, 2007, was not the Republican Party that people imagined it was, and not the Republican Party that existed 10 years, 5 years even earlier in many respects, that the party had gone off the rails. And the idea that it was just with Sarah Palin, I think, you know, it was indicative of just how far things had gotten. But it wasn't the cause. It was really more of a symptom of the Republican Party, because you had a guy like John McCain who was literally running as a maverick. I am more independent. I am not a movement conservative. And then he goes around and he picks Sarah Palin, who is the most conservative. And I don't mean this on a scale. I mean, she is the perfect epitome, right? And really now what we have is Donald Trump, who is Sarah Palin, but with more money.
Well, you know, this Daily piece, it really depends on what your definition of went off the rails is.
Right.
Because, you know, we look back at Nixon, just corrupt as hell. Ford, you know, not remembered for being an intellectual powerhouse. Reagan, corruption. George H.W. Bush, warmonger. George W. Bush, warmonger and corruption. So, you know, we've got decades here of just pure corruption, stupidity at every level. But Sarah Palin, to an extent, is the first one to come along that wraps it all up into one unelectable package. So I don't necessarily think she is when they went off the rails. I do think she's the symptom. That's when the tumor emerged. And it was Sarah Palin. And it's ushered the way for people like Louie Gohmert, Michelle Bachmann, Donald Trump. She's created
Ben Carson.
A new party. Yeah, Ben Carson. She's created a new rail that they're going on. But, you know, they were headed that direction anyway. Sarah Palin or not, they were going there.
And let's be clear here. Now, I agree with you that the Republican Party has had a long time history of both corruption, of at least, you know, dating back to the Civil Rights Act in 65, when you had the Dixiecrats move into the Republican Party, where they have been pursuing an electoral strategy that is largely based on racism and racist fears. But the ilk of the Republican Party that we see that is different now from like the Nixon era, and even to a certain extent Reagan, although maybe that's really when things really started moving in that movement direction, is a combination of the theocracy that exists in the Republican Party. And we see that with Ben Carson. I mean, his entire campaign is built upon his theocratic musings and his support from right-wing fundamentalists. But we also see sort of a complete absence of policy ideas, right? I mean, you know, Nixon, he started the EPA. Yeah. You know, Reagan, at the very least, and it's obviously incredibly discredited, see Sam Brownback if you want proof of this, but Reagan at least had this sort of bizarro notion that if we cut taxes, we're going to raise revenue. There is no policy position that defines the Republican Party anymore. The only thing that seems to define them is this notion that has been sort of propagated by the conservative movement, is you got to talk tough and you shouldn't be politically incorrect. I mean, you shouldn't be politically correct, I should say. I mean, honestly, this is an entire ideological movement, and one which has taken over a political party based solely on some personality traits. And I'm not saying shared, you know, as individual personality traits. It's not a cult of personality. This is an entire movement that has been built on the idea of embracing certain personality traits. And frankly, you could the most easily define those personality traits as being a run-of-the-mill a-hole. I mean, that's basically what constitutes. And that's why you have a guy who is a certifiable a-hole as the national front runner. And the only person who's even challenging him is another guy who is a sociopathic a-hole. He's just more soft-spoken, but the guy can't get through three sentences without implying that somehow we're living in Nazi Germany times, and Barack Obama is following Mein Kampf as some type of playbook. I mean, this is pure insanity, except for the fact that we've had 10 to 15 years to absorb it and understand that this is a political party.
It's interesting when you put it in those terms, because this does feel like we're living in satire. I mean, you know, this shouldn't be how it is. This should not be the American democracy. But my God, this is it. Donald Trump, depending on which poll you're looking at this point, because Carson is right there nipping on his heels. But look at those two guys. I mean, Donald mm-hmm. Trump, more bankruptcies than most people could even fathom. But then Ben Carson, who I don't know what happened to Ben Carson in his head. You go from being one of the most renowned brain surgeons in the world in all of history to suddenly being the craziest person running for president as a Republican. I wouldn't let this man carve a Thanksgiving turkey, let alone get near my brain.
The big benefit, and it's been one that we've been talking about and hoping for a considerable amount of time now, which is that the longer guys like Ben Carson and Donald Trump control the imagination and the polls and are leaders way out in front, and, you know, I remember a time when people thought Jeb Bush was going to be the front leader. As long as that happens, with each passing day, what happens is that the conventional wisdom begins to understand that this is not a function of Trump or Carson per se. This is a function of who the Republican Party is. Now, what's strange is simultaneously, the Tea Party itself, that branding, is on life support. It is less popular than it has ever been. I mean, so, you know, this notion that somehow Donald Trump is playing to the Tea Party. The bottom line is Donald Trump is playing to the base of the Republican Party, and they simply have decided that we no longer are getting any value out of the branding that we went through before. And now it's just sort of like the vultures just picking at the corpse, sending out emails talking about Agenda 21. And will you send us money because the UN's going to come and take your car and force you to ride a bicycle or something. They have now dipped from a high of 32% to a five-year low of 17% in terms of the Tea Party's favorability. And it is a fascinating phenomenon that this Tea Party thing never really existed. It was always just a branding choice. And now they are embracing a guy like, remember the time when we were told that somehow the Tea Party was about anti-bank.
Yeah.
I mean, these people are embracing Donald Trump as if he was, a drink of water in the desert. And Donald Trump is really no different than Mitt Romney in many respects. He's just not as polite and is wealthier. And he's got that same delusion. Talk about what Donald Trump said earlier this week, Farron, because it reminded me of the same privilege that that Mitt Romney would talk about. Frankly, the same privilege that a guy like Andrew Cuomo would talk about. It is fascinating to hear people who were given everything on a silver platter say, hey, I was given everything on a platter, but it wasn't necessarily, it was only silver as opposed to like gold. Tell us what Donald Trump said this week.
Well, what he was handed on that platter was a big check for $1 million from his father. But he told this crowd this, that, look, I only got $1 million from my father to go start my businesses. And then, God, woe is me. I had to pay it back with interest. You know, things have not been easy for me. Those were his words. Things have not been easy for me. Now, Sam, you know, just like you, I remember the first time I got the check for $1 million from my father, just like most Americans remember very clearly. That doesn't happen. And that's what Donald Trump doesn't get. He is trying to now rewrite his own history to say, look at me. I went from nothing to something. You know, I only got $1 million. Well, guess what? At the time when he got $1 million, that same amount of money today would be worth almost $7 million with inflation. So,
right. Well, even if it wasn't worth $7 million today, even if it was worth $1 million,
right,
that's quite a stake to get at a low, who knows what the interest rate was. But to get a loan like that, and I imagine he didn't have to put up any collateral, right? And if he did, it probably came from his father in the first place. So the idea that you would have option, listen, just having access to credit like that,
right,
is out of reach for a vast number of Americans in this country.
Well, we see that talking point, that's brilliant. I mean, you need to start advising them. But what he's doing is he's playing on the psychology of these Republican voters, because I think by a margin of about 65%, even people over the age of 65, they still believe that in their lifetime, they're going to become millionaires, that they're going to be a part of that 1%. And so Trump is trying to say, look, I did it. You can do it. But he's leaving out the privilege part. He's saying, forget the fact that I was born into it. We can all do this because I did it. So why can't you? And they believe it because they want to think that it can happen to them. And he's playing off the psychology of that.
Well, I'm not sure I agree with that, Farron, because, I mean, to a certain extent, I mean, look, here's the bottom line is the reason why Donald Trump can't express it the way I just did, because if he did, his policies would be different. I mean, you know, and frankly, he is sort of taxation policies are far more progressive, I think, than the rest of them. But if Jeb Bush, for instance, who complained this week that, you know, he doesn't have to be doing this, he could be out there doing cool things. I mean, the privilege that is inherent that is so embedded in them. And it was the same thing with Mitt Romney, who actually mused if his his surname had been Mexican, if his dad had stayed in Mexico, that he would definitely been president by now, which, of course, is just a bizarre delusion on his part. But the idea is that for these guys to maintain the perspective and the policies that they do, they cannot perceive themselves have gotten any advantage. They have to maintain some type of fiction, just like the same fiction that Ben Carson talks about. Hey, if I got chased by with a guy with a gun, I would go all, a diehard on him. This is a fiction they maintain for themselves that allows them to propagate these positions. And when Donald Trump says, hey, I didn't get any handouts, I didn't get any advantages, I just got a $1 million loan from my dad that I had to repay back, what he's communicating to his followers is not just playing on their notion that they may be millionaires, but instead what it's saying is that you don't know anybody else anything. Even as absurd as it is to say I didn't get anything from anybody except for a $1 million loan from my dad at a low interest rate, if I can say that, then you, Joe Schmo, you can definitely say that society gave you nothing. You can definitely say that your privilege as a white guy hasn't brought you anything. You can go out in the world and you can be stingy. You can maintain what is yours. You can make sure that society is not just and shares and functions to the benefit of everybody. Because, look, if I can do it, you can certainly do it. And he's not sending him the message that you can get money from your dad. It's just that he's sending the message you can be as big of an a-hole as I am. But, Farron, I'm afraid we're out of time, but I have a feeling we'll be able to talk about this more next week.
Absolutely. Thanks, Sam. This week, Hillary Clinton launched a new attack line against Bernie Sanders, claiming that the Vermont senator is a sexist. Hillary is trying to capitalize off of the feminist movement, which represents a huge portion of our population that has been unfairly repressed by federal policies for far too long. But thinking that Hillary is better on women's issues just because she's a woman is very misguided. Recently, I had the chance to speak with Dr. Heather Gautney about the two candidates' records on women issues, so let's take a look at that interview. So, Dr. Gautney, we right now have seen Bernie Sanders be criticized a little bit over the fact that maybe he is not the best person to handle women's issues. After all, the Democratic, front runner in some areas right now is a woman. So logic would dictate that maybe a female would be better on female issues, but logic's not always happening in politics. We can go through a record here, and that's one of the best things about Bernie Sanders is he has a record. He has decades of service that we can go through and really see where he stands on these issues. So lay it out for us a little bit. Where does Senator Bernie Sanders stand on women's issues?
Yeah. First I'll say that I completely agree with you that there is this sort of glass ceiling kind of politics right now around the Clinton candidacy, that if she breaks through the glass ceiling, there's a lot of excitement about a woman president and breaking the glass ceiling. But I really think that that's not, that doesn't really constitute a political strategy, right? And the idea of having an elite woman in this sort of elite post doesn't necessarily translate to advance the well-being of people, at the bottom of the class structure. So I think Bernie Sanders, the sort of big picture of Bernie Sanders' candidacy is that he's very much focused on bringing up, the living conditions of people at the bottom. And so that's really where his work on gender inequality really intersects with problems of class inequality and income inequality. I think that's what Bernie sort of in some ways exceeds what Clinton is doing. But as you said, going through the issues, one of the biggest issues facing women right now is the problem of the attacks on reproductive health and women's access to abortion. And that's something that's coming from obviously much of the Republican Party and from conservative movements. And there's been a shocking amount of activity at the level, right, in state legislatures that have really impinged on women's right to choose and their ability to access reproductive health services. So, Clinton has you know, to give her credit, been very good on these issues. But one of the problems, if you look deep into her history on this, is that she's always described abortion as something that she would hope that would be rare. And that really serves to stigmatize abortion. Sure, we can choose, but we would hope that you don't choose this option. And so I think that really feeds into the, these conservative arguments that they should, that, that women's right to choose be limited in some kind of way. And they're doing that, you know, they're requiring women to undergo ultrasound and mandatory waiting periods and all kinds of other forms of humiliation. So I think that's one of the contrasts between Sanders and Clinton.
Well, you know, I just want to add to this a little bit. Right now, the Pope has come out in recent days and said, look, any priest, if you have women in your congregation that have had abortions, you know, go ahead, grant them forgiveness. It's okay. We now have a Pope, which, by the way, they don't need to seek forgiveness for anything.
Right.
But the fact that the Pope has come out, the leader of the Catholic Church, one of the holiest people on the planet, and he is to the left of the Republican Party on women's issues.
Right.
I mean, that really tells you something about how horrible the Republican Party has become for women. You know, we saw this in 2012 with Mitt Romney, you know, making these asinine comments about binders full of women. and this war on women that Rush Limbaugh helped launch really hasn't gone away. And that's why these issues right now are so important, because these attacks have not stopped. And that's why we do need an advocate in Washington, somebody that's going to stand up and say, this is absurd, this is obscene. And Bernie Sanders has really taken on that role in saying, you know, one of the best issues here, you know, paid maternity leave, family leave, whatever you need. Bernie Sanders is leading that charge, and it's coming from somebody that people really didn't expect to be a leader in women's issues, and he truly has become one of the leaders on this.
Yeah, and I think that there is again, this is what I was talking about with this intersection of class and gender. You know, 80% of Planned Parenthood's clientele are, you know, low-wage women. Planned Parenthood, you know, these attacks on Planned Parenthood disproportionately affect a particular sect of women, right? It's not, wealthy women are not going to Planned Parenthood to access these kinds of services. So this focus on, you know, people who are in these low-income situations, I think, is really, really crucial, and one of the places where Bernie really far exceeds the other candidates. You know, you mentioned family leave. I mean, this is another one that's really interesting, because Clinton, she has made that a centerpiece of her campaign. But as I mentioned in an article that I wrote in the Huffington Post, she, in an interview, said to CNN that she didn't think that was possible, that she didn't think that family leave legislation and paid leave was actually something that a president could get from Congress. So that is not encouraging, right, to voters, when she's already coming with this sort of defeatist mentality, you know, whereas Sanders is on the complete other end of this, not just talking about family leave, but looking at Scandinavian models, which is really and very robust social safety net, right, that allows people and families, right, to care for sick family members, and women to have time off, to have children and to care for their newborns. But this is also linked, right, to providing universal health care and, you know, other, you know, a safety net that people can actually count on. When things fall through the cracks, or when they encounter some kind of difficulties, lose their jobs, et cetera, et cetera. I think another thing that Sanders is really strong on, and a really important contrast between him and Clinton, is on the issue of income inequality, in particular pay equity. Now, again, Hillary Clinton has made pay equity an important part of her campaign. But it's not enough to have equal pay if the pay is already very low, right? If your minimum wage is too low, you know, then that's only the first part of the problem. It doesn't solve, the bigger problem of income inequality. And The truth is that 2/3 of all minimum wage workers are women, and 2/3 of all tipped workers are women. So this is an issue that very specifically affects women. And Sanders has been calling for a $15 minimum wage. And in fact, really, I don't even think he's married to that dollar, because he's talking about a living wage, which in many places is much more than $15. And Clinton has called for a $15 minimum, but only in the state of New York, and, you know, in following with what Andrew Cuomo is trying to do in New York. In other places, or for the rest of the country, what she's been sort of clocked at saying is $12. So that's just simply not enough for people to live on. And of course, you know, as I mentioned before, the minimum wage is really a women's issue. So one would expect that a woman president would take up that mantle. And Bernie Sanders has actually done better on that count.
So in the grand scheme of things, I know there are a lot of progressive women in the United States who still, you know, their support is firmly behind Hillary based on this assumption that she's going to be better on women's issues. So how do we, I don't want to say necessarily we need to change people's minds, right, but how do we do a better job of educating them? You know, how do we lay out the issues as you have done in your article and say, look, here's the difference in the records. These are the facts. This is what has happened. This is not, you know, opinion, commentary. This is what's happened. Now make your choice. How do we accomplish that?
Yeah, I think there's two ways. The first is, of course, just to do what we're doing now, right, which is to review the record, to write about it, to enter Sanders into the discourse as a person who has been excellent on women's issues, and to really expose his history on this, right, to allow his record to really shine. I think the other way, and this is one of the areas where the Clinton campaign just had a very clear advantage on the Sanders campaign, is outreach. You know, reaching out to domestic workers groups, you know, women's groups concerned with reproductive health, and really asking, you know, bringing people in and giving them a seat at the table, and giving them a sense of where Sanders stands on these issues, and showing that he does exceed Clinton on many of them. And, you know, she just started with a ton of money and a huge bureaucracy and was able to go and do the kind of outreach. But I think now that the Sanders campaign is really rolling, I think a lot of the people that made these early commitments are going to want to rethink their positions and perhaps back Sanders, because he's much more in line with what they're trying to do, you know, what these organizations are trying to achieve.
Well, Doctor, thank you so much for joining us today. This is great work. Keep it up. Let's get the message out there. And, you know, the best thing we can do right now is to keep the voters informed. And that's all we're trying to do. You know, it's not about changing minds. It's about keeping people informed so they can make the very best decision for them. And thank you very much for sitting and talking with us today.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
And that's all the time we have for tonight, but you can get more news, video, and commentary on our website at ringoffireradio.com. And you can subscribe to our daily podcast. Just go online to rofpodcast.com. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you next week.